Good morning, yeah. Oh yeah, that's happened to me before too. Well, sometimes you just gotta do the best you can, you know, what you have. Really? Makes sense. Yeah, me too. I think we've all been there. I could definitely see that. Sure. Yeah. No, I could see that in certain situations. I have no reason to lie. Yeah. These are progressive lenses. They're new. Totally not used to them, so have to bear with me a little bit. They're actually making me a little nauseous. They are, aren't they? They're expensive enough. I know, it's just like, for what these glasses cost, you know. So, you know, as a kid, I paid, I think, $1,200 for a car. And for me to get two pair of glasses would have been like, let me think, 16, 17, $1,720. Like, I bought a pretty nice Ford Granada, 78 Ford Granada. 586 for like 1,200 bucks, 1,100 bucks. So, yeah, I definitely agree with you on that. I mean, the prices of things are just totally ridiculous. I can't understand it myself. It's just, it's stupid. It's stupid money. Well, the thing is, I have to look straight ahead, and it's, I can't look to the side. Everything's blurry, so it's just. But I know you wanted to see. Everybody wants to see me try. Oh, please try them. See if they work for you. Yeah. Yeah, it was about 85, 86. How about you? Really? I don't know. I'm trying to remember when that came out. Well, there was that movie, The Sure Thing. I liked that actress in it, but she didn't do much after. She did a few roles. She was in that medical movie, remember? You know, how everybody liked John Cusack back then. John Cusack was pretty cool. He still is. I mean, what is, you know? I like him. He's a great actor. Well, there was A Sure Thing, and then Pretty in Pink and all that. That came, it was like 83, 84. Yeah. Revenge of the Nerds was 84, I think. Well, I think Better Off Dead was filmed around then, but yeah, Curtis Armstrong was in both movies, yeah. Oh, he's a great actor. He's still around. He's been in some TV shows. Yeah. I don't know. You know, I don't know. I don't think John Cusack ever got married. I think he was... I think he was the backup. Like the reserve actor for Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas if Johnny Depp didn't work out. I don't think he was, I think he was hired to like a stand-in or something. Oh, don't even get me started on Terry Gilliam. Don't even get me started on Terry Gilliam. What? The director's director. I mean, everybody talks about Kubrick. Ooh. Terry Gilliam. Oh my goodness. From the makers of Monty Python and the Holy Grail. Yeah. From the same people that brought you Monty Python and the Holy Grail. And the Meaning of Life and Life of Brian. It's like funny that, you know, they made Life of Brian and Meaning of Life, which are hilarious movies. But today, they still talk about the Holy Grail. Terry Jones was, yeah, co-director. Well, even, we were talking 73, 75, maybe then, yeah. Well, it was financed by Keith Moon, I think. Yeah. I don't think the Who financed it. I think Keith Moon did. That was the drummer. He was the drummer for the Who. Yeah. No, he died. No. Yeah. So, 81, 82, maybe. Oh, David Bowie. No, he wasn't in that. You know, it's funny that Yellowbeard was not a Monty Python movie, even though, like, John Cleese was in it and, you know, some of the other actors. Graham Chapman was Yellowbeard, yeah. Well, I think he did die of AIDS, but he had the drinking problem was what led to, he had trouble acting because he couldn't remember his lines. So they would have to give him his lines, feed him his lines, which I find amazing. Oh, well, I don't think he ever accepted himself that way, no. I heard the rumor. I think it was just talk about the sequel to The Holy Grail. Yeah, where they were all old knights and they had Graham Chapman in the Holy Chalice. Because he had died at that point. And he would just be like a voice talking from the, Holy Sepulchre. The Holy Sepulchre. I don't know. You have those moments of clarity where you think, Eric Idle had this career, John Cleese had this great career, Terry Jones had a great career, Terry Gilliam, and you think, they just couldn't get in the same room and do more together. But they came together every once in a while, like every so many years. And, I don't want to call it cashing in because I think they did a great job. But they would come back and do like reunion tours and everything. Mm-hmm. Oh, no. Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas was one of those comeback films for Terry Gilliam. He had had some, not poor. Well, it's all about box office. It is. It's all about box office. And, he had some hits and misses in there. And I personally for instance, that was that Don Quixote movie. Yeah, never got made. I've seen some of the film from the Don Quixote movie, and, you could tell everything was just going south. Yeah. Well, Terry's about there again. He's out there again, yeah. Well, I don't know, it's just like, these things just go, wonky sometimes. Best plans, mice and men, backers, the actors, and then you find out your main actor that you've basically centered the whole production around has a slip disc back problem. Can't ride horses. Can't do any of the riding scenes. And so that caused a lot of the problem. And then you're filming in a desert, and it rains. You think, rain in the desert terraforms the desert. The whole desert turns green. Life just springs up like anew. It's like you're in an oasis. And, I know. Could you imagine? I find it hilarious. You're going to film in the desert. It rains and everything turns green. It looks like you're in Central Park. Only Terry Gilliam could go out in the middle of the desert and that happens to him. Yeah. I don't know. I think about that Would John Cusack have been better in Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas than Johnny Depp? I don't know. I'm a big Cusack fan, but I like Johnny Depp. I mean, I don't. You know, I'm not into that all that pirate stuff and the overacting and. I mean, the guy can barely stand up, then he sword fights 50 guys. I just don't. I like it, but. Yeah, I know I gotta get that report done, too. I've been there myself. Yeah. Well, lately, I've been. Binge watching. Dexter. Have you ever seen the show Dexter? It was a Showtime show. It's on Netflix now. Yeah. And I don't know. They've almost turned him into a superhero by season 3. And then I'm getting into season 4. And John Lithgow's running around acting like a serial killer. It's like, I don't know. Part of me thinks... Sometimes I actually sit there and I think that John Lithgow is one of the most underappreciated actors in the American cinema. You know, sometimes I think, you know, if he hadn't done World According to Garp, you know, where would he be today? You know, would he be like the Jack Nicholson of his generation? But... I just love John Lithgow. Oh, he's amazing in everything, isn't he? I really think so. Underrated. I think he's appreciated. I think he is, you know, well loved. But I think he's underrated. He just never really, you know, he never did the. You know, the Kinsey role or the, you know, or the, you know, where he just kind of took the lead. Oh, that Kinsey movie was terrible. Oh. Tell me about it. Thank you. I'll get that back to you right away. Okay. I'll just add it in. I'll do it now. Okay. Sure. Yeah, they're new. Thank you. Okay. Sure, I'll see you there. Say that. Come on. You. What we don't know. You can ask her. I don't know. Well, you know, I'm not into that. Yeah, just go home at night, you know, have a beer, you know, work out on the treadmill, watch a little Netflix. See what's on Hulu, you know. Justice League, yeah. I want to see Justice League, too. I know. I think it looks good. I'm, you know, everybody makes fun, but I want to see it. I like the Superman movies. I really do. I do. I got to get started on this. Yeah, the Superman movies are great. I think hiring a British actor to play Superman brings a different perspective into it, you know? Different sensibilities. I think Christopher Reeve was the best, but that was a different time. I think Henry Cavill's is wonderful. Sure. I have that here somewhere. 14. 14. Yeah, you can write that down there. Yeah. Well, 14 will do it. In the past. I don't think I have. I'll check. Sticking together. Well, it's just one page. Feels like it's sticking together. No, it's 14. Yeah. Oh, see, I'm not like that. I think Ben Affleck's doing probably one of the best Batman there is. I mean, it's Batman. I mean, Bruce Wayne is like, you know, put on the costume, now you're Batman. You know, everybody thinks Bruce Wayne is pretending to be Batman, but actually, Batman is his normal self, who he is in his private moments. Bruce Wayne is his alter ego, the one he's pretending to be. You know, he's always Batman. Batman's, you know, he's a psychotic sociopath. You have to be driven to put on a bat suit and chase people around the city. But I've never, you know, Dexter's like that. You know, is there a way to control chaos? You know, is there a way to be completely immoral, evil, megalomaniac, narcissist, take people's lives in your own hands and still be functional? And I think so, because, you know, you think about, there's functional alcoholics all over the place, drug addicts, people have heroin addicts, you know, for heroin addictions for 10, 15 years before anybody realizes. People are addicted to painkillers for years before anybody sees the cracks in the porcelain, you know. And a lot of that, you know, the desire and the need to be normal, to blend in, you know, to put on those glasses and become Clark Kent and blend in to society. I think that's where that comes from. You don't have a choice. You have responsibilities. You know, you have a mother at home that's expecting you to go to work every day to support the family, or, you know, a wife and kids. Okay, you've got a wife and kids at home. You can't go on a bender and not go to work the next day. You've got to pony up and take the aspirin, drink the coffee, sugars, put an extra scoop of sugar in there, you know, get the sugar high, get your ass in the car and keep on going. Yeah, I don't know. I don't like to think of myself as going down that rabbit hole, but you definitely, as you get older, you've got to lay off the booze and the cigarettes and the late nights. And, you know, like a friend, I had a really good boss. He was a friend too. And he used to say, never drink on a school night. It's good advice. Never drink on a school night. Well, we weren't at school. We were at work, you know. Carl, you remember Carl. He's a great guy. And he is. Yeah, Carl was really good to me. And I do miss him. Yeah. Well, he said that. And what he was getting at was that, you know, you got to put that stuff aside when, here, I'll sign it with that. You have it there? Okay. Okay, there you go. I didn't know. Really? Okay. Sure. Yeah. I'll bring my wallet at lunchtime. Okay. Oh, I can't believe I have to take a collection up for Mark. I can't believe Mark passed. He was so young. Still, he was retired for 8 years, maybe? Well, let's see. Yeah, 55, 63. It was about 8 years. That's not a bad run. I do miss him. He was good to me. We kind of parted ways there at the end, kind of poorly. I wish we would have done things differently, but... Well, he just wanted to go. He just wanted to cut ties. I understand that. I don't hold that against him. He'll have to do a collection for him. That's nice. For his family. I guess it's who we're collecting for, though. He's not having a funeral or calling hours. He didn't have no kids. I don't know. Let me think. Well, he lived with his sister. He has the two sisters, I think, are still alive. But, yeah, you can just give them, I don't know. Maybe just give them, I don't know, what do you do? Send a meat tray or something. I mean, you just give him a check and a card, but I don't know. Well, his sister lived with him, so he could just give it to her, I guess. I don't know. Yeah. No, I know. Well, that's the way it goes sometimes. Well, remember, good, better, otherwise, he lived the life he wanted. You know, so, I think he went to a couple World Series. Yeah, he was married a couple times, but I don't think he had any kids. Yeah, that's true. All these things happen. Okay. All right, I'll see you at lunch. All right. Yeah. Yep. Fist bump. Into that fist bump stuff. I don't know. I don't know where that stuff started. Do you do that? You do the old, you know, fist bump. I don't know. It's kind of silly. Now what are you gonna do? Really? Sounds good. No, I brought something. I got a sandwich. Well, If I eat a salad at lunch, then I'm just hungry all afternoon. So what I do is I have my bigger meal at lunchtime. And I just eat a salad, a little bit of tuna or something, or a small piece of salmon for dinner. It's working. I'm around 1500 calories a day, and it's working. Yeah, just look at me. I'm a sex machine. I know she's. I don't want to, office romance is always a touchy thing. But you're single. You could, well, you can just go out as friends. I don't know if she is or she isn't. Just go out as friends, have a cup of coffee, that kind of stuff. See where it goes. I know. Tell me about it. One was enough for me, I'll tell you that. Okay. Well, it was good catching up with you today. I know, we gotta go to that meeting after lunch, yeah. Well, we'll catch up then, I guess. No, it's okay. I've been there myself. I totally have been there. All right. Sure. Okay, I'll see you then. All right. Yeah. Fist pump. Fist pump. All right, I'll see you then. Take care. Hard to believe sometimes. There, I'm talking to myself. I'm gonna get in trouble again. You too. All right, bye. Okay, I'll let him know. Her.